A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I start in the name of Allah, the Beneficent and the Merciful, and I seek salvation from Shaitan the Accursed. My dearest viewers, my brothers and sisters from across the world, Assalamu alaikum jamian wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to once again welcome you to another episode of the Ramadan Show with me, your host, Dr. Shabbir Tejani, here exclusively on Imam Hussein TV. Once again today we would like to inspire you, to give you some food for thought for this month of Ramadan, to be your one-stop shop for this holy month. Inshallah, we hope that you can join in too on social media by using the hashtag IHTVRamadan on Twitter. Join us on Facebook, Instagram and YouTube also. The show will be going up onto YouTube tomorrow, inshallah. I would also like to ask you to send in your videos and your clips from wherever you are, so we can gain an insight into how you prepare for this month. And also, your brothers and sisters from across the world can also benefit from this. Before continuing on to the show, I would just like to quote something from the Holy Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Those who strive in our cause, surely we will show him our path or our way." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows here that if you take a step in the way of Allah, and if you strive to struggle in His way, He will be your guide and He will never leave your side. Inshallah, if we keep this in our minds as we're going through this month, and remember to constantly think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask Him to guide us, then surely He will not let us down and He will answer our prayers. Today for spiritual refinement, inshallah, I want to talk about a specific topic, a topic that molds the very fabric of our society, a topic that forms the fundamentals of the future of our communities, and that is raising children. How is it best to go about raising children? And as a parent, what is your duty towards your child? How can you get the best out of them so that they're not only upstanding citizens in society, but the best Muslims they can be and the best human beings they can be? Inshallah, what we will go through is, firstly, we'll talk about some of the hadith of the A'imma alayhi salam. Secondly, we'll talk about some aspects of training, some things you can apply to your day-to-day relationship with your child. And lastly, we'll talk a bit about mistakes that you can make as a parent, with or without intention, that can cause a problem in your relationship with your child, and therefore will make your child become distant from you. So inshallah, over the course of these next few minutes, we will talk about all of those things. One of the duties of every parent, or the fundamental duties, some people would argue, is to raise your child in the right way. Some parents just feel that physical catering or sustenance is enough for a child, but there's so many other things that are important to children: psychological well-being, emotional support. Other things are important to their spiritual upbringing, things like good traits and characteristics, so that they can develop pious and virtuous personalities. When we look at raising children, we have to look no further than the ultimate guides, the Ahlul Bayt. I just want to read a small passage that Amir al-Mu'mineen left in his will to his son, Imam Hassan alayhi salam, where he told him about how to live in this world, and the advice he gives is so beautiful. So I'll read it verbatim, and inshallah, I hope that you listen and it will strike a chord with you. He says, "I found you a part of myself. Rather, I found you my whole. So much that if anything befell you, it was as though it befell me. And if death came to you, it was as though it came to me. Consequently, your affairs meant to me as my own matters would mean to me. So I've written this piece of advice as an instrument of help. Certainly, the heart of a young man is like uncultivated land. It accepts whatever is thrown upon it. So I hasten to mold you properly before your heart hardens up and your mind gets occupied, so that you may be ready to accept through your intelligence the results of experiences of others and be safe from going through these experiences yourself. Amir al-Mu'mineen here highlights such an important facet of parenthood, and that is to try and give your children teachings, give them experiences from your own life to stop them from going astray. Inshallah, what I want to do now is talk about some aspects of training. There are many parents in society, many new parents, parents who haven't been given advice from other people, and they may be wondering, they may have very good intentions in their heart, but they may be a little bit lost and wondering, what's the best way to go about trying to raise children? So I've got some tips here that we've put together, and inshallah, as I go through them, I'm hoping that you take note and it strikes a chord with you, because in these nights of Ramadan, this month is so special, not only because it's emotionally uplifting and spiritually enlightening, but also because in this month, for a very, very special reason, for a unique reason, families come together. You tend to spend more time with your children, especially when it comes to times like iftar, suhoor, during the a'mal, during the dua, during the majalis, you sit together. So make use of this month to build a stronger relationship with your child. So the first aspects of training is guidance. Naturally, the primary role of a parent is to show their child right from wrong. So you want to teach your child the very principles of right and wrong and then expand upon them. You teach them good manners, good morals, good social values. The child should also be taught about not only healthy ways of being as a person, but healthy ways of living, and how to develop good social skills, have good relationship with other people. And the other thing is, you should teach them how to serve society, because essentially your children will form part of that society. After that, once you've taught your children the fundamentals, you then go on to teach them self-control. They should be taught that a human being differs from an animal because of intellect, rational thinking. Therefore, a child must learn to control, rein in their emotional desires and their animalistic instincts. Emotions like anger, jealousy, greed, selfishness will all be a part of growing up stages. All children go through these. But as a parent, you have to teach them how to deal with these emotions, how to mold their personalities, and how to allow rational thinking rule their hearts, essentially allow their minds to rule their hearts and not let the emotions take over. After this stage, I want to talk about another stage called change. A lot of children have certain traits, and it's intrinsic, it's installed within them. Some children just are more shy than others. Some children are more fearful than others. It is very important that you pick up these habits in your children, this way that they are, and try to mold them, try to improve them, give them good training, and try to put them in situations where their personality, if it's something that is too excessive, can be challenged. Because these personalities, if they're in moderation, may be a good thing, such as if they're shy. Sometimes it's not a bad thing to be shy. But if you're too shy, it hampers your progress. The same with fear. If you're fearful, there's nothing wrong with being fearful, because there are things that happen in society where you need to be aware and be careful. But being too fearful, again, can hamper your progress. The parents need to assess the negative traits first. Assess the negative core personalities that the children have, and then try and think of a plan to overcome them. Useful tactics may be to have a chat with the child first. Talk to them about stories, narrate the history of the A'imma, tell them about how their positive traits allowed them to go up in this world and reign over the heavens because of their pure personalities. The other potential things you can do is speak to their friends or speak to their the teachers and find out if there's specific things that they're doing in class, which you may not be seeing at home, but they see in school, and it may be a negative trait that you haven't picked up yet. Then the next stage is exploiting potential. You see, every human being, from the moment they're born, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has installed within them potential. Now this potential is there from the moment they're born. But as time goes on, and the more you waste time, the less that potential becomes. So you must, as a person, as a parent, try to allow your child to experience and try to achieve the full potential that they have. They should be encouraged to develop useful hobbies. And if they have an interest in something, try to expand upon it. And in fact, if you can spend time with them with that hobby, it would be useful. There's very, very talented children in our communities today. And inshallah, I pray that as adults, as parents, as teachers, we can allow them to expand on these traits. You look at children today, they're into fields such as poetry, recitation, memorization of the Holy Quran, learning of the Arabic language and other languages in fact. You see, it's not only confined to Islamic subjects. There's some very talented children, children who are talented in computing, for example, or mathematics. Make sure that the children firstly are appreciated. You tell them that they are good at that subject and then allow them to expand upon it. The next stage, and I think probably the most important stage of parenthood, is being a role model. Be a positive influence in your children's life. You see, because we've been taught through the teachings of the A'imma and through other historical events that actions speak louder than words. No matter how much advice you give to your child, if your own actions are completely contradictory to that advice, your child won't listen to you. For example, if you tell them to pray on time and you yourself are sitting watching television, or you're sitting there talking to your friend whilst the time of salah is passing, your child will get confused. They will think to themselves, hang on, my parent has told me to go and pray, but yet they don't see the value of prayers themselves, so surely it can't be that valuable. And then your child will develop these traits as their own. It's very important that as a child grows up, he grows up or they grow up in a home where prayers are maintained and the dhikr and the stories of the Ahlul Bayt are being repeated over and over again. Because it's only when you remember the Ahlul Bayt, you remember what they've given for us, you remember their sacrifices, you remember their lives, you remember their positive traits, do you actually inspire your children? Because let's face it, there is no greater inspiration than the Ahlul Bayt. And as your children are inspired, they will go on to inspire other people. They will inspire future generations. In terms of advice, these are the main advices we would give you for raising children or allowing children to achieve their maximum potential. I just want to remember a hadith from Amir al-Mu'mineen where he gives advice and he says that split your child's growth up into different sections. Three main sections he's identified. And he said that allow the first 7 years of life, allow them to be your master. Allow them to be children. At the end of the day, young children are children. If you allow them to be children, they will develop these traits themselves. They will have specific good points and they can develop upon those. When a child plays, don't think that they're wasting time, because when a child plays, they're developing other things like visual hand-eye coordination. Sometimes they develop social skills when they're playing with friends. So don't think of playtime as a negative thing. Then Amir al-Mu'mineen says, after the years of 7 to 14, be their master. Teach them discipline. Teach them to be thoughtful. Allow yourself to mold their minds. Allow yourself to not be overbearing, but at the same time, with discipline. Teach them the benefits of being a positive person, contributing positively to society. And with discipline and being regimented comes a positive trait, and that is things like punctuality, timekeeping. They will be able to impart these skills and these characteristics onto other friends and also to their own children. And in the final 7 years, in this particular segment, Amir al-Mu'mineen says, from the age of 14 to 21, allow them to be like a friend. Allow them to be your advisor. Because if you have done things right from the age of 0 to 14, you've given them the ability to develop, but then reined in at the same time. By the time they're at the age of 14 and they have developed their own rational thinking by their teen years, they will then be able to give you advice when you need it. When you have a question, they might be able to help you to answer it. When you have a dilemma, they may be able to sit down with you and talk through it with you. And that's what you want from your child. You want your child to be someone who can help not only himself or themselves, but help you, help your family, help society. After this, I want to talk about the role of the mother. You see, when we look at the ladies in the religion of Islam, we'll be talking about Lady Khadija and Lady Fatima al-Zahra in upcoming programs. We are talking about the role of the mother. When a baby is born, unaware of the world outside, the mother plays such an important role about introducing them to the world. As a doctor, seeing when a baby is born and how they respond when they're given to their mother is a beautiful thing. You see, whilst they're in the womb, the interesting thing about children, newborn babies, is that they don't see very well. They only hear and they feel. And when they're in the womb, the only thing they've been hearing is their mother's heartbeat, and they've been feeling the warmth of their mother. So when a baby is born for the first time in their life, they're exposed to the world, they miss that comfort. So when a baby is given to its mother, when it hears the mother's heartbeat and feels the mother's warmth, it gets reassured, it calms down. It's a beautiful connection, an immediate connection. And then after that, the mother plays a role in making the home. The mother molds the child's attitudes towards life, religious or otherwise, and gives them perspectives, goals. Eventually, the child matures and their views change. But you see, if the fundamentals are strong, if you've instilled good values, good morals in them, even if they develop their own way of thinking, those morals won't change. They'll be good persons within themselves. And that's why the role of the mother is so important. Finally, the thing I want to talk about is the mistakes parents make, which drives the children away from them, which creates distance in the relationship. And these are mistakes that you must try not to make, because what happens is that the children remember. And when they grow up, they remember these things that happen to them, and it creates distance even at an older age. So don't do these things. The first one is two parents arguing with each other in front of the children. What that shows the child is that the parent doesn't have respect for the other parent. So as a child, you begin to think, why? Why should I have respect for my parents if they don't have respect for each other? The second thing is, don't be negative towards your child. Don't constantly highlight negative traits. Work upon the positive traits. Give them encouragement. Allow them to build their own self-confidence, their own self-esteem. Thirdly, never expect too much from your children. By that, what I mean is that don't push your children into things that they're not strong in. From a very young age, I've seen, especially in my community, that if a parent sees another person's child be very good at something, they'll push their children to do that, even though the children are not interested in it. Remember, every child has their own strengths, their own weaknesses. They're special in their own way. So you must work on your child's interests. Allow them to develop their interests. Don't be critical if they're into things like the arts, if they're into things like sculpting or writing. Often in our community, we want our children to become doctors or engineers, and not all children are wired up to do those things. Some children have other talents, other skills, so allow them to develop those. Next, I think it's probably the most important thing you should never do to your child, and that is humiliate them in public. Because it has such a profound impact on the child's self-confidence, their own self-esteem. Because if a parent humiliates you in public, in front of their friends, in front of their family, you start thinking to yourself, if my own parents don't appreciate me, who else in society will? Your parents are seen as the closest bond, the closest relation to you in all of your life, essentially. So make sure, as a parent, you don't put your children in that situation where they feel so distant from me, they become isolated, and they have such low self-confidence and low self-esteem that they can't achieve their potential. Finally, the mistake that a lot of parents make is that they keep their children away from orphans, they keep their children away from the less fortunate. I think it's very important that we allow our children to have a look at what the lives of the orphans are like, what the lives of the less fortunate are like. Why? Because firstly, it allows them to develop a sense of society. It shows them that not everyone in society is equal. After all, children don't understand the meaning of rich and poor. They develop this as they grow up. Secondly, it helps them because they see the bounties and the mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them. And thirdly, it softens their heart. It makes them feel a sense of relation towards these people. After all, we're all one humankind. We're all human beings and we all have the core principles of humanity within us. And if you develop on the core principles of humanity from an earlier age, as you get older, you tend to be softer in your heart. You tend to help the poor, you tend to help the needy. And inshallah, as a society, if we can remember these specific teachings, I think we will grow up and be strong. We will have children that will grow up to be in the army of Imam Mahdi alayhi salam.
Imam al-Sadiq, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, has said, if the month of Ramadan remains safe and sound with respect to sins, then the entire year shall also remain so. The month of Ramadan is the beginning of the year.
Inshallah, on today's show, as we go across the world to look at how people prepare for this holy month, we're going to be focusing on one specific city in the country of Iran, and that is Isfahan. Isfahan is known as one of the most beautiful cities in the country of Iran. But today I want to focus more on how they alter their lives for the month of Ramadan. Firstly, like many other Iranian countries, the working hours are altered for the employees. So stores tend to stay open through the day, but for employees and for people that work in offices, for example, their working day changes slightly. Normally it starts at 8:30 in the morning and finishes by 2, so that they can go home and recuperate and get some rest. For the stores, though, they tend to stay open. Maybe if it's the hottest time of the year, they tend to close in the afternoons for a few hours, as it's tradition in many of the countries across Arabia. For iftar, one of the traditional dishes is called halim, and it's eaten with eggplant. To me, it doesn't sound like a very appetizing dish, but to them, they love it. So a lot of them eat it in the month of Ramadan. The other thing they really like is this. It's a sweet called gaz. Inshallah, I shall be tasting it a bit later on and see what the fuss is all about. But apparently, it's very nice. During the month of Ramadan, there are regular majlis in the Husseiniyas, in the mosques. During the Amal night, people tend to gather together to perform the Amal as a community. And also, one of the other traditions that's there in Isfahan is that every night in the month of Ramadan, the people tend to recite one juz of the Holy Quran per night. As I've requested before, it would be great if you could send in your videos and we can have a look at how you prepare for this holy month, how you go about your day-to-day lives, and what alterations you make to make the most out of this month. Finally, before we go into the next segment, I shall be tasting this to see what the greatness of it all is. Let's see.
Oh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Peace and blessings of Allah be upon each and every one of you, our dearest viewers. May all your prayers and supplications and a'mal be accepted during the holy month of Ramadan. Today, we are in one of the stores that sell sweets in the holy city of Karbala. There is a specific sweet that is specified for the holy month of Ramadan, which is called Zlubia and Bamiya. This specific type, you can find it only during the holy month of Ramadan. The visitors of the holy city of Karbala, as well as those who live here, love this sweet. They come to these stores and buy this specific type of sweet, which is specified to the holy month of Ramadan, which is called Zlabia and Bamiya. Imam Hussein TV viewers, I have one of the brothers here. I will ask him a few questions. Assalamu alaikum. Alaikum
assalam.
ممكن تعرفنا بنفسك وتشرح لنا عن أوضاع مدينة كربلاء في شهر رمضان؟
والله بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. مناسبة حلول شهر رمضان مبارك. نقدم التهاني والتبريكات للشعب العراقي بهذه المناسبة. أجواء روحانية خاصة يعني خميس وجمعة زوار وافدين من كافة المحافظات إلى محافظة كربلاء لتقييم زيارة الإمام الحسين عليه السلام، خاصة يعني الخميس والجمعة أكثر شيء يعني الزوار الوافدين من كافة المحافظات. بلي.
Brother is saying that congratulating you and the Islamic Ummah on the arrival of the holy month of Ramadan. And he's saying that the holy city of Karbala is normal and visitors from Iraq and other countries come to the holy city of Karbala, and especially during the holidays. ممكن تتفضل لنا عن الحلويات اللي مشهورة أكثر بشهر رمضان؟
بالنسبة يعني أكثر الزائرين بشهر رمضان الطلب يكثر على البقلاوة، على الزلابية، على البانية، كل الحلويات. بلي. لأن شنو الجسم يحتاج إلى طاقة، سعرات حرارية بعد الإفطار، فأكثر الإقبال كلش شديد بشهر رمضان يعني على الحلويات أكثر شيء. بلي. أكثر شيء زلابية والبانية والبقلاوة كلها يعني بشهر رمضان، خاصة خميس وجمعة يعني وفود الزائرين من كافة المحافظات إلى كربلاء.
نعم زين. استقبال الناس بالنسبة للحلويات بداية شهر رمضان أكثر، لو من تقرب أيام العيد يصير أكثر؟
لا، بداية شهر رمضان الإقبال يصير على الحلويات يعني من البداية، وبالعيد بعد أكثر يصير لأن استقبال العيد.
I asked the brother about the sweets that they make. He's saying that we have a special sweet that which is called Zlabia and Bamiya. It's a local Iraqi sweet. It is specified for the holy month of Ramadan, as well as the other sweets. As I asked him about the visitors who come to the city of Karbala, whether they buy sweets or not, he's saying that yes, especially during the first days of the holy month of Ramadan, people need this energy and they get their energy from the sweets that they buy from here. Oh.
For today's episode of health tips and general medical advice, I wanted to talk about a specific facet or a specific health risk that causes problems like heart disease, which also affects a person's personality. It's actually not a physical health problem as such, but it's actually the concept or the problem of stress. Stress has been studied for many years, for many decades by scientists, and has been shown to have detrimental effects on the body, because obviously stress in itself causes changes in our human being. Why am I talking about it today? Because stress has actually been proven to have an impact on the risk of developing heart disease. In science and in psychology and sociology, we have something called a type A personality. This is talking about people who have a personality which is very intense, very furious, people who tend to have very small amounts of patience and tend to become very stressed at very little things. Usually you'll find them in high-flying jobs. Often you'll find CEOs or very high-ranking professionals who are extremely, because of their tight schedules, they're always rushing, they're always stressed, they're always frustrated. And they find it very difficult to unwind from this after a hard day's at work. So as a result, what happens is that the stress is pent up and it's within them. And it just builds up over time until one day, or over the course of many years, until one day something drastic happens, like they have heart problems or they're going to develop a stroke. Because stress in itself changes things in the human body, and I'll explain exactly how. Stress causes specific hormones to be released in the human body. Hormones such as cortisol, which is known as a stress hormone. Cortisol in itself causes changes by making us more awake. Cortisol increases the blood sugar levels in our bodies. And also what it does is it causes a surge of adrenaline through the body. People who are always stressed and frustrated can sometimes go on to develop problems with anxiety. The reason being is that they're always in a heightened state of awareness because of the sympathetic activity. Sympathetic nervous system is known as a fight or flight response. And as a result, when you get a surge of sympathetic or surge of adrenaline, what happens is that your heart rate goes up, your blood pressure goes up, your blood sugar levels go up. You tend to have a tremor, some people do. And so as a result, what happens is that generally you feel very unwell. However, this response of the human body is in reaction to the stress, because when you're stressed, your body wants for you to be in a heightened state of awareness so that you can fight that stress, whatever the stressful factor is. So the question is now, how does stress actually cause heart disease? How does stress cause strokes? How does stress cause a detrimental effect to the human body? As I've explained, the sudden rush of adrenaline, the release of cortisol, and other hormones around the body which are released during the times of stress. And as a result, what happens with high levels of cortisol the whole time, that can have a negative effect on the body, because the high sugar levels caused by the raised cortisol can affect your immune system. People are stressed all the time, tend not to have enough sleep, tend not to eat enough, and as a result, generally they are physically less able to do things, they have less energy to do things. And as a result, their adrenaline system needs to go into overdrive. And that's why you find that these people are not in equilibrium, not only physically, but also psychologically. So the question now comes that, okay, if you've got stress, in the body, the actual pathophysiology of how that actually causes heart disease, how does that happen? Well, as I've explained, your heart rate goes up and your blood pressure goes up. You tend to be anxious all the time. Some people go on to develop depression over many years. Because you see, stress affects the human body in ways that are known to us but are also unknown to us, because there is a deep psychological impact of stress. The physical impact obviously is that when you have a high blood pressure due to the stress and you have high sugar levels due to the stress because of the certain hormones that are released, they in turn increase the risk of heart disease. As I've mentioned in previous shows, what other risk factors of heart disease there are. So that increases the potential risks. The other things that stress does is that it doesn't allow you, people who tend to have stressful lives tend not to pay attention to things like a good diet or a healthy lifestyle, exercise, and as a result, generally they deter in their own physical health. Stress in itself affects the mental ability to process things as well. Over many years, studies have shown that people who are stressed all the time find it difficult to focus. So therefore, when they do specific activities that are not related to the focus of their stress, for example, you'll find people who lead very stressful jobs, like doctors, for example. I'm a doctor, and I know what a busy on-call can be like when you're extremely stressed out. Apart from the things that are make or break, for example, when dealing with the life of a patient, where you can make good judgment calls and you can act rationally, apart from those, you tend not to be able to focus on other things. When I'm working on call, if it's a busy shift, sometimes I find it difficult to eat, I find it difficult to drink enough fluid through the day. And when I get home, because it's been a long day, I've worked for 13, 14 hours, I don't sleep on time, and the next day the cycle's repeated, but except for the fact that I'm more tired than the day before. And this is a repetitive cycle for some people for many, many years. And as a result, it becomes detrimental to their health. They don't sleep, they don't eat, they become physically weaker, and also psychologically it has an effect. So why does stress affect people psychologically? Well, as studies have shown, that people who are always in a state of stress, they have higher production of certain hormones, certain neurotransmitters. However, due to the release of these hormones, they are always awake. So cortisol is known to keep people awake. Adrenaline, when you have a surge of adrenaline, you find it very difficult to sleep. So people who are always stressed will always be awake, and lack of sleep has a negative effect on mental stimulation, mental ability to do things and process things. And as a result, psychologically, they're worse off. Science has also proven that people with a class A personality or a type A personality actually are more prone to developing heart problems, prone to developing heart attacks, strokes, cardiovascular disease. And as a result, my advice to you would be to find ways of dealing with stress. The question is how. There are many strategies that we will talk about during these nights when it comes to meditation and stress, especially when we talk about focus during prayer. We'll be talking about strategies you can use in order to reduce stress, calm your mind down, so that you can focus on other things such as prayer. And this in turn will reduce your levels of stress. A lot of people who are regular, who pray regularly and give precedence to their prayer, who pray with complete attention and focus, say that when they finish their prayers, they feel a sense of not only satisfaction, but also a sense of calm within them. And this is one very good way you can improve your stress levels. Other ways are taking an hour or a couple of hours out of your busy schedules in order to contemplate and think, meditate. Other ways of reducing stress is exercise. It has been found that people who exercise regularly tend to have lower levels of stress. And also, apart from exercising, try to spend time doing other things away from work. Take up hobbies, take up interests, and spend time on those. For example, if you like a specific sport, try to play it or try to perform it at least once a week. That way, at least you have something to look forward to during the course of the week. And on the day that you do the activity, that's something that you do that takes your mind away from the thing that causes stress. Inshallah, through the course of these nights, we'll be talking more about causes of heart attacks. And in our series, we'll also be talking exactly what a heart attack is, what you can do if you are suffering from one, if someone around you is suffering from one. Inshallah, we'll be talking about strokes as well. So I hope you tune in for those segments of those particular episodes.
Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, peace be upon him, narrates from his father, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, peace be upon them. One day I came to Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, may Allah rest his soul in peace, and greeted him. He replied to my greetings, but since he was blind, he asked me to identify myself. I said to him, I am Muhammad, son of Ali, son of Hussein. Jabir said, O the son of the best and the holiest human being, come closer to me. As I went closer, he hugged me and kissed my hands and tried to kiss my feet. I pulled myself away and prevented him from doing so. And then he continued, the Messenger of Allah, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, had told me to convey his greetings upon you. I replied, may peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad and his holy household. I then asked, O Jabir, what is the story behind this? Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari asked, and he said, one time I was with Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and he said to me, O Jabir, perhaps you will live long enough until you meet a man of my children whose name is Muhammad, the son of Ali, the son of Hussein, one of my great-great-grandsons, to whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted the light of wisdom. Give him my greetings. As everybody may know, Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari is one of the great companions of Prophet Muhammad and Imam Ali. He participated in Badr and many battles of Prophet Muhammad and Ali. Jabir had always been a follower of prophethood and imamate, and he never neglected their love and affection towards them. It is also significant to note that Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari is the first pilgrim to the holy shrine of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, in Karbala. He became blind at his old age and died at the age of 90. It is narrated that he used to sit in the mosque of Prophet Muhammad and say, O Baqir al-Ilm, the splitter of knowledge. The people of Medina thought that Jabir was going mad. But he said, by Allah, I am not saying nonsense. I personally heard Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, say, O Jabir, perhaps you will live long enough until you meet a man of my children whose name and appearance are similar to mine. He will split the knowledge perfectly, and you will see, and when you see him, give him my greetings and salams. So when you see him, give him my greetings. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
For this episode, the poem that I want to recite will be dedicated to the individual, that personality who is the lifeblood of every Shia around the world, the personality whose name our heart constantly beats, and that's none other than Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. This poem is called Forever, and it encompasses everything that Imam Hussein has given for us and what his sacrifices meant. What has become his legacy. It's been written by myself and my brother Abbas, and it is about Imam Hussein's everlasting name in this world. This is a promise to you, Hussein. We will remember your grief and pain. Your sacrifices are not in vain. Your message lives on until today. Forever this world will call out your name. The cry from all of humanity in every street, in every city will be Ya Hussein. Forever your call will live in our souls. In every beat, in every breath, in every moment, every step will be Ya Hussein. You stood against the 2,000 men. You were alone in that barren land. Your blood was splattered across the plains and purified every grain of sand. Forever that land is liberated, where millions flock to see your shrine. The chants on their lips all the time will be Ya Hussein. Hussein, you taught us the way of life. You showed it to us through sacrifice. Your final stand and your final cries. Those moments were witnessed by the skies. Forever we will remember your day. It is a day that's like no other. The name the skies will cry forever will be Ya Hussein. We say Hussein and we're filled with hope. Your name enlightens our very soul. There will be a day this world will know who is Hussein and what is his goal. Forever living your revolution. Your legacy shall never die. The movement that will always thrive will be Ya Hussein. We are the people that are oppressed, because in your grief we beat our chest. They call us Rafid, but they forget that Fatima prays for our health. Forever we shall remember your grief. And even if we're faced with death, the only name on our breath will be Ya Hussein, Ya
Imam al-Sadiq, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, has said, if the month of Ramadan remains safe and sound with respect to sins, then the entire year shall also remain so. The month of Ramadan is the beginning of the year.
As we conclude this episode of the Ramadan Show, I want to leave you with a final thought, a message, something that will get you to ponder and to think. These upcoming nights are nights of reflection after all. When you reach a crossroad in life, or when you face a decision, it is sometimes better to take your time to come up with the answer to decide which road to go on, rather than taking the wrong road altogether. This tells us that during our lives, we'll be faced with many decisions. Sometimes it's important to reflect and contemplate, to think long and hard before deciding which way to go. Because the problem is, if you make the wrong choice, coming back can often be much harder. I would like to thank you for your time and for your attention. Once again, I would like to ask you to please send in your videos and to also join us on social media, on Twitter, on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. I would like to ask you to pray for us on these spiritually elevated nights, on these nights that are like no other. Please remember us in your du'as, and more importantly, please don't forget to pray for the reappearance of the awaited Imam, alayhi salam. I bid you farewell with the following words. Wassalamu alaykum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.